first I want to ask, who has a dog? Raise your hand if you have a dog. Okay, all right. So, the passage, I'm going to talk about a couple of passages. This is not going to be a typical sermon. This will be a very short sermon. But it's not your typical sermon. So I'll talk about a couple of passages. One of the ones I'm talking about is Psalm 27. And it says, I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land that we're living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and take heart, and wait for the Lord. So it's about waiting for the Lord. And here's a statue. Does anybody know what statue that is? Anybody? Anybody know what the name of this statue is? No? Hachi is his name. Ko in Japanese, and you put a ko at the end of something, it's a term of affection. So this is a statue of a dog. His name is Hachiko, and he is at Shibuya Station in Tokyo, one of the most busiest stations in Japan. Does anybody know why his statue is right there? No? It's a very famous landmark. You ever go to Japan, Shibuya Station, you'll see tourists surrounding this statue of his dog. I'll explain to you why he's with his statue there later on. But I also want to talk about it's not working. Oh, there you go. Thank you. Okay. So also, at the end, we're going to sing this song, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. So this song is written as a Christmas song by Charles Wesley a long time ago. But he also sang about not just the fact that Jesus was born on the earth in the manger, but that he's also singing about, wrote the song about a longing for Jesus to return. Because Jesus came to the earth, he was born in the manger, he lived on the earth, and then he died on the cross, and he went up to heaven to be with the Heavenly Father and with the Holy Spirit to be with us. But the Bible also teaches that one day Jesus is coming back. And so he wrote this song not only about Jesus coming to the earth, but also the anticipation of Jesus coming back to the earth. So the words of the song is, Come thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. Right? From our fears and sins release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child, and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal spirit, rule in our hearts, rule in all our hearts alone, by thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. So this is about Jesus being born during Christmas, but it's also about, you know, he came, but it's not fully, like, realized as our king in the earth. And so it's like looking forward to Jesus and waiting upon Jesus, and that day when Jesus comes back to the world. So we'll see that later. But then I'm going to talk about dogs now. So 2018 just happened to be the year of the dog. Is anybody here born the year of the dog? Raise your hand if you're born the year of the dog. Okay. So I was born on the year of the dog as well. So these are, according to the Chinese zodiac, this is the characteristics. Okay. So 2018, year of the dog. Now tell me if this describes you, those who are born the year of the dog, right? Dog's most defining characteristic is their loyalty. They will never abandon their friends, family, or work. Honest and just, they are popular in social circles. Everyone needs a dog friend for advice and help. They are also good at helping others find and fix their bad habits. Despite how they act, they are worried and anxious inside. However, they will not let this stop them. Once they decide on something, no one can persuade them against it. Huh? What do you think? For those of you guys who know me, am I kind of like this? Sort of? Right? Am I like this, Chloe? I am, right? I am? Okay. Anybody else? The other dog? Oh, how about justice yet? Okay, okay. So Lee is like that. How about over here? Are you like that? Anxious inside? Okay, okay. That could be. I'm not very, very anxious inside. Maybe when I was at the pastor bar, I didn't pass the bar. I was like that. But generally, I'm not really like that. But okay. Yeah, sounds pretty good. So this is the year of the dog, right? So this dog here. So my love of dogs. So I have a dog. I have a dog. And I love that guy so much. I had him something like 6, 7 years ago. So this is not my dog. This is, my love of dogs began when I first came to America from Taiwan. I was in first grade. And I've never had dogs before in Taiwan. It's just, you know, around where I live, there's no dogs. I've never had any interaction with dogs. But when we came to the United States, we lived in Michigan, and my next-door neighbor had a German Shepherd. It was just like that. And I still remember her name. Her name was Kelly. And it was so awesome. This was my next-door neighbor. And so I could, and they were very, very friendly. They were so nice. There was this white family next door, and they would welcome us, because we just moved to Taiwan, and so they would welcome us to their house and invite us to Thanksgiving and take me to baseball games, which, you know, taught me all these American stuff, right, how to do what Americans do. And so they had this dog, and so I was allowed to go over any time I want to and just play with Kelly, and to my heart's content. And so from that time on, I really fell in love with dogs, and I wanted a dog. And I wanted my parents to give me a dog, but they refused to give me one because it was too much time off on me. So they didn't want to do it. So my whole life, I never had a dog until finally, and this was one of my favorite books, Where the Red Fern Grows. Raise your hand if you read this book. Have you read this book? A lot of you guys in school, you know, this one, the sign reading, is so good, but so sad. Such a sad, sad book. It's about a boy. He has two little red bone coonhounds. One is, the boy's name is Old Ann, and the girl's name is Little Ann. And how she takes them to go hunting them. And in the end, it's very sad. So this was one of my favorite books when I was a little kid. This story of this boy and two dogs. And so I never had a dog until 8 years ago when one of Chloe's students' dogs had a puppy, had a litter of puppies, and she didn't know what to do with those. You know, she had a bunch of puppies, and she asked Chloe, "Do you want one?" So we're like, "Oh, okay, sure. Well, we'll take one." So we thought about it, but we just, you know, never really like seriously pursued getting a dog. But since Chloe's student had a litter of puppies, we just went, and then we met somebody in the parking lot, and she had two. One is brown, one is black. And so we picked the brown one, and he was very quiet. He was kind of like, they were both in a box, and he was kind of like this. And the other one was kind of like really hyper. And so we're like, okay, I think we should pick up the calmer one. So we picked him, and we named him Chewie after Chewbacca in Star Wars. And this was like his first day at our house. He was exhausted. When he came to our house, he was like, he just went down a corner by dead video games, and then just like lay down and come to sleep. And so just really, really tired. So that was when his first day of us, and eventually he got a little bigger, right? He's dead. He was just really and got bigger. And now that's full grown. And I'm not sure exactly what kind of dog he is. I think he is probably part lab. Maybe he has part shepherd, maybe part, I don't know, just like a mixture of different breeds. He is very loyal. He's bonded to us very closely, but he's also not very friendly. So, like, unless you get to know him, some of you guys, if you've ever been to my house, like, he'll bark really loudly when you first come to my house. He'll bark really, really loud and because you're a stranger. But once he kind of gets to know you, then he just wants to play with you. Like, yeah, he'll like be on his back, you know, in front of his feet. He's like, come play with me. So that's what he's like. That was when he was sad. One time he stepped on a nail. I don't know how he stepped on a nail in my backyard. And he looked on his foot, back foot, and there was like a nail sticking out of his foot. He just basically went through his foot. We didn't know like how that happened, but it did. And so we took him to the vet. And we had to remove that nail from his ear palm. He like this minor surgery. And so this is him when we took him to Grand Canyon. This is like the furthest trip we were taking him. And this is him when we took him to the beach. And so because of him, I learned so much about my relationship with God. I know it's weird, right? How do you learn about your relationship with God from a dog? One of the things I learned is through him is how God relates to us when we sin. You know, how God loves us unconditionally, but whenever we sin against God, he hates sin. And so in the Bible, we have examples of when God people sin and God kind of like, you know, turns away from them. But then how God still loves them. So how does that work? You know, how does God still love someone when they sin? And I learned from Chewie, I got a little bit of idea what that is like. Because something about Chewie, we love him very much. He barks too much. Okay, that's one thing we don't really enjoy, or we don't really appreciate. But another thing about him that we don't like is that sometimes he likes to eat his own poop. Okay. He started doing, I mentioned this sometimes before. He likes to eat his own poop. And he's done that ever since he was a puppy. And we did everything we could to make him stop. You know, we Googled on the internet how to make your dog stop eating poop, right? And so eating his own poop. So we would be like I would basically take hot sauce, like Tabasco sauce, and just we would feed him and wait for him to eat and then poop. And I would run over to the poop right before he tries to eat it, and I would pour the hot sauce all over it, right? And he would sniff at it and he'd be like, nom, nom. He would just eat it. So I took like the hottest hot sauce, like the ghost. I bought the ghost pepper hot sauce, the hottest hot sauce that you could. And so I did the same thing, you know. I fed him, and then he pooped. And I ran over, I poured it all over. I'm like, huh, if you try eating that, you'll never eat poop again. And he's like, and he still ate it. It's like, oh no, it doesn't work. So this is the thing. Whenever he eats his poop, okay, his breath smells like poop. You know, his mouth, he has poop in his mouth. He has poop on his tongue. And so whenever he does eat his poop, we still love him, right? We still love him. We don't stop loving him when he's eating his poop. We're not going to abandon him. We're not going to kick him out, right? We still love him. But whenever he eats his poop, we just don't want to be around him, right? He might lick us or come over, and he's just like not clean. So like we're like, oh no, we just like run away, right? And so from there, I kind of got the idea that maybe that's how God is with us, right? Whenever we sin, whenever God's people sin, of course God hates sin, God can't stand sin, but you know he still loves us. He will never abandon us, but he just doesn't want to be too close to us at that time when we have poop around us, whenever we're sinning. So that's kind of an idea that I had from our Chew about God's relationship with us. So that's one thing. And okay, so now I want to talk about Hachi. Hachi, the dog, the statue that I mentioned earlier. Hachi is a Shiba Inu. Okay, does anybody have a Shiba Inu? Anybody? No? Okay. Shiba Inu, this is a Shiba Inu. It's gone viral. For some reason, this picture of this particular Shiba Inu has gone viral. You can see it everywhere. People would add like words. But this is a Shiba Inu, and these dogs are the national dog of Japan. They're native to Japan. They were bred the hunters, and they are very loyal, and they are very closely bonded to the owners, but they're kind of like Chewie. They're not very friendly with strangers until they really get to know you, so they'll bark a lot to you, and they may seem kind of unfriendly, you know, when you first meet them, until they really get to know you and kind of earn their respect and their trust, and then they will be like very closely bonded with you. And so they were bred to hunt, they're bred to resist the cold, that's why they have a lot of thick fur on them. And they were, at one time, they were so prized that in Japan, they passed a law that only the emperor of Japan and his household can own a Shiba Inu. Nobody else, it was illegal for anybody else to own a Shiba Inu at one time. So, Hachi, the dog that the statue of the dog I mentioned earlier, is a Shiba Inu. And his name, Hachi, means eight. Right? His name means eight in Japanese, and ko, again, is the term of affection. We don't know why his name is eight. It could be because it was a litter of eight puppies, and whoever the owner of the mom was, just says, okay, you're one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. And then Hachito was number eight. And he was born on a farm, November the 10th, 1923, in Odate, in the Akita Prefecture, close to Tokyo. And eventually, he was taken by Dr. Hidesaburo Ueno, Dr. Ueno. Dr. Ueno was a professor of agriculture in Tokyo National University. At that time, it was Tokyo Imperial University. And so he took him home to be his pet, and they bonded very closely, and Hachiko and Dr. Ueno loved each other very, very much. And Hachiko would never want to leave Dr. Ueno's side. But then Dr. Ueno, he needed to go to work. He needed to take the train to go to Tokyo National University to teach his classes. And he would take the train at Shibuya Station. And Hachiko would always try to follow him. And Dr. Ueno did his best to try to, you know, keep him from leaving the house or leaving the yard, but Hachiko would always find some way of breaking out of the yard so that he could follow Dr. Ueno all the way to Shibuya Station. But once he got there, the people, the train didn't allow dogs. They had no comfort dogs or guide dogs at that time. So they didn't allow any dogs to ride the train. So what ended up happening was Hachiko would just sit there at the train station and just wait. And Dr. Ueno would take the train to Tokyo National University. He would go there and he would teach his classes. And after he was done with his classes, he'd get back on the train and come back to Shibuya Station. And there, Hachiko was sitting right there, right outside the station, waiting for him to come home. And eventually, everyone around there in the station, the people that worked on the conductors and the people that worked at the train station and the people, the vendors around, they all knew that Hachiko and Dr. Ueno, and knew that this dog would follow this professor to the train station and sit there and wait until the professor comes back from his classes from the middle school back home together. And they did this for years, right? And but then eventually what happened was one day, Dr. Ueno went to the station with Hachiko, and Hachiko sat at the station and waited for him. And Dr. Ueno got on the train, and he went to Tokyo University, and he began teaching his classes, one of his classes. And in the middle of his lecture, he had a brain aneurysm. And right there, he passed out, and he died. And he came to the hospital a little bit, but it was too late. And so he passed away. And Hachiko was still at the train station, right? And Dr. Ueno was never able to come back because he passed away. And so Hachiko sat there for 9 years, 9 months, and 15 days, waiting for Dr. Ueno. And he was able to survive because you know, all the vendors and the conductors, they all knew who he was. They all knew who he was waiting for. And so they would feed him and kind of take care of him. And, but he stayed there. That's where he stayed. Dr. Ueno's wife would, and family would try to take Hachiko back home, but Hachiko would always break out again. He would never be able to, contain. He would break out of the, somehow break out of the yard and come right to the spot and sit there to wait for Dr. Ueno to never come home. And so eventually Hachiko became quite famous because one of Dr. Ueno's students did some research on the dog, and he wrote some articles, published some articles about Hachiko and Dr. Ueno. And Hachiko became quite famous, and everyone kind of knew who he was and why he was sitting there waiting for 9 years, 9 months, and 15 days, waiting for Dr. Ueno. This is Hachiko with one of the trained conductors. He knew him, and he knew Dr. Ueno. And eventually he died at the age of 11. This is some of the people that worked at the station and the vendors. They found him on the street. He died of old age. I think they did an autopsy. He died of cancer or something. And so, you're Japanese. So that was him when he died. And eventually, his story touched so many people. The story of his loyalty. So many people that they built a bronze statue and put it on the spot where he would wait for his Dr. Ueno. And this is 1948 when Helen Keller, she's the blind deaf teacher, the statue. And the statue has been there ever since to this day. This is another statue that was made much later of Hachiko and Ueno at Tokyo University, and then being reunited. And this is Shibuya Station, and there's Hachiko to this day. So if you ever visit Japan, if you ever go to Tokyo, this would be one of the spots that a lot of people would visit. And a lot of people would use his statue as a landmark. Like, oh, where do we meet at Shibuya Station? It's so crowded. Right, and there's so many people who would say, oh, meet me at Hachiko. Okay. And so they all would just use that as a meeting spot. So, a couple of passages. We're coming to the end of the sermon. A couple of passages. Romans 8, 23. It says, this is the Apostle Paul writing to Christians. Says, not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we are saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. So we, as Christians, we have the first fruits of the Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit in us. But it's not enough. It shouldn't be enough. Right? There should be something inside of us that hopes for something more, something greater. And that hope that we have is for Jesus. Jesus to return, to be with Jesus. This is the hope that we have. And then Lamentations chapter 3, this is in the Old Testament, the prophet Jeremiah. So, Prophet Jeremiah, right, he's looking around at this world, at the world that he's living in, and all the sin and all the corruption, and he's like, man, this world is messed up, right? So he says, I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. And nothing has really changed, right? We can look at the news. I was thinking about doing some kind of year-end recap of the sermon today, because today's the last Sunday. And I looked at the news of what happened in 2018, and it was just so depressing. It's just too depressing. I'm like, how am I supposed to teach a sermon on all the terrible things that happened this past year, right? So I'll preach on dogs then. probably better. So it's like, but it's the same thing with Jeremiah, right? He says, you know, I remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassion never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. I will wait for him. Is that how you feel this morning in your relationship with God? Do you long for Jesus? Do you wait for his return? In Psalm 27, one thing I seek in the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. Is this the only one thing that is in your heart this morning? Verse 13. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait. You must return to your God, maintain love and justice, and wait for your God always. This is what we do as Christians. Right? Because our hope is not in this world. Our hope is not in our society. Our hope is in Jesus. We know that one day he will come back, and all the crap that is happening in this world, he's going to fix all of it. He's going to fix all of it. So that should give us hope. And even though we're facing with all this stuff that's going on in the world, this is the hope that we have in Jesus for you. Okay, I'm going to show a clip. I had a clip that I was going to bring to show you guys, but I forgot to bring it. So I looked on YouTube to find something else. So this is what I found. So it's like 4 minutes, so I'll just show you, kind of give a little brief synopsis of the movie. I'll just let you guys watch. Oh, by the way, stop. Don't play yet. So this is the Americanized version of the movie. So they took the story and they adapted it to America. So Richard Gere, he plays the Professor Orlando. He plays, I mean, everything is the same except it's in the United States. It's not in Japan. But the dog is a Shiba Inu. Okay? It is a Shiba Inu dog. So we'll just watch it.